Good day, Macedonia. This is the Macedonia Minute, and these are your weekly announcements. Thanks to all Macedonians and guests, we're glad you joined us today. We want to express a heartfelt welcome to all our guests. Your presence has made our time here that much more meaningful today. To say thank you, we have a guest reception prepared for you at the end of worship. We hope you will join us. This is the Macedonia Experience, and we are excited to worship our God together today. Corporate worship is participatory, so feel free to join us in singing, clapping, praying, and praising throughout. We lead. We love, equip, activate, and disciple. Join us for our lead sessions, also known as Sunday School, on Sundays at 9 a.m., followed by corporate worship at 10 a.m. Come be equipped to lead with us in our Lead Institute on Tuesday at 7 p.m. Stay up to date and informed by liking our Facebook page at MMBC Covington. Subscribe to our YouTube channel at Macedonia Covington and bookmark our website at www.macedoniacovington.org. Here are your announcements for the week.
Please remember those on our prayer list, including our pastor and his family, as well as our bereaved families. Happy birthday to Aubrey Hurd. She celebrated her birthday on August 20th. LaToya Howard will celebrate her birthday on August 23rd. And Mother Rose Bagby and Shirley Russ will celebrate their birthdays on August 24th. You may join us on YouTube Live at Macedonia Covington, our church page, on Facebook Live at MMBC Covington, our church page, and on our Periscope page at MMBC Covington. As always, our weekly bulletins, prayer lists, and Bible study handouts are located at www.macedoniacovington.org. Click on the Virtual Worship tab. There are three ways you can give today: through Cash App at $MMBC Covington, give by mail at Post Office Box 269, Covington, Georgia, 30015, or you can give online at bit.ly/Macedonia Give. Thank you so much for your faithful giving that makes ministry possible. Have a great week, and God bless you, and may heaven smile upon you, is our prayer.
Good morning, Macedonia. Good morning, Macedonia. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, saints, give God a hand clap of praise. If it had not been for him on our side last night, where would we be? But we're back in the house of the Lord one more time. We're going to go ahead and get devotion started. Won't prolong things for today. Glad to see some people in here that I hadn't seen in a month or so. But God is good.
Amen.
He's good. I can walk and talk. Oh, I got a testimony, but not this morning. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, you know the storm is passing over.
Oh,
is a day that the Lord has predestinated, blessed, and made.
Amen.
A day we've never seen, we never shall see again.
Yes.
But while we're still on this side of the earth, while we can walk on the grass and the grass not growing on top of us,
say it, Reverend.
We need to lift up holy hands to the Lord.
Yes.
And give Him some praises. He's still worthy to be praised.
Amen.
From the rising of the sun until the going down of the same. Yeah. Let us pray. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus. All of our sins and greed to bear. What a privilege it is to carry. We can take everything to God in prayer. Lord, in the matchless name of Jesus, we come once more to say thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you for all your unmerited favors. Father, you've been good to us down through the years. You took us through pandemic and pandemic, Lord.
Yes.
You kept us safe down through the years. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
That you supplied your grace and your mercy, Father. And you keep on blessing us over and over and over again. We thank you, Lord.
Yeah. Thank you.
Father, be a blessing on us today. Let us receive your word, knowing that your word is the final authority.
Yeah.
Bless us with your word, Father, and let us go out and live your word.
Well,
Father, we know you're the bishop of our souls, the Father.
Yes.
Let us gather your word and teach those that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, for everything.
Thank you, Lord.
Bless those that are less fortunate, Father. Look into the hospital and the convalescent homes.
Yes.
Be a blessing in everyone, Father. And Father, we know you're the potter. We are the clay.
Yes.
Shape
sir.
Us
yes,
and
sir.
Mold us in your own way.
Yes.
Mold out all the sins of omission and commission. And throw it into the sea of forgetfulness, dear Father.
Yeah.
Never let it come up again. And Father, when the preacher preached for our Father, let us realize that your word. It's so important to us, Father. Let us live by your word, dear Lord. And we thank you for your word. Thank you for everything, Lord.
Yes.
And we be so careful to give you the honor.
Yes.
We glorify, magnify your
yes,
name.
Sir. Yes, sir.
We ask these blessings all in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Certainly we thank God just for being here.
Yeah, yeah.
One more time.
One more time.
Amen, church.
Amen. Amen.
He's been good to us. And I just want to thank him.
Thank you, Lord.
Through the years, I keep on toiling. Lord, I'm toiling. For the Savior, I'm again.
Ah! Yes, sir.
And my image but you me. But I keep marching on. Ooh. Till you come to carry me home. Lord, when my Lord, when the gates, sweet Lord, oh, I walk on in.
Yes, sir.
This is what I tell him sometimes. Lord, teach me.
Teach me, Lord.
How to treat my neighbor.
Yes,
every day I want you to teach me, Father. How to love my friends. Friends talk about me.
Yes,
my Lord.
My God.
And my image misuse me. But I keep marching on.
Amen.
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 annual homecoming. May God bless. That ends our devotion of service. We're going to turn it over to Pastor Browns. Come on and give us some love. Amen.
Yeah. And he's all right. He's all right. I done tried him and I know that he's all right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
If my grandmama here, she say, if you're talking about Jesus,
yeah,
he's a friend,
yeah,
of mine. If you're talking about Jesus, he's a friend of mine. If you're talking about Jesus, he's a friend of mine. If you're talking about Jesus, he's a friend of mine. And every year at homecoming, you had folk that came to church,
yeah,
from miles around. And they just wanted to remind you that one of these days won't be long.
Yeah.
All of us got to get out of here. And they say, it's getting late in the evening. And the sun is going down. See, y'all young folk don't know what that means,
yeah,
but it's getting late in the evening,
yeah,
and the sun is going down.
Yeah, yeah.
Y'all don't know about that, but they were trying to tell you that you better get right, because your soul got to have a resting place, because one of these days, it won't be long. You're going to go in your room for the last time. You're going to open your hymn book,
well,
for the last time. You're going to open your Bible for the last time. You're going to lay down and press your head to a dime pillow. And the bed you laid in going to become your cooling bowl. And the sheets you laid in gonna become your whining sheets. But I know some of y'all get scared and upset when we talk about death. But I learned a long time ago, it ain't no harm in dying if you know where you're gonna go. And as Elder Kirkland said, when the gates swing open, some of y'all got confused, cause they say, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And you might have thought he was talking about the gates of hell. But the gates of hell is only one gate. But they tell me in that city, it's built on a firm foundation.
Yeah.
And there are 12 gates in the city. 3 gates in the east. 3 gates in the west. 3 gates in the north. And 3 gates in the south. When I was younger, I went up and asked the pastor, "Pastor, what gate I'm going to go in? Since it's 12 gates." He said, "I'm not worried about which gate. I just want to make sure I get through a gate. Because when the gates swing open, I want to walk in." We've gathered here for another homecoming to celebrate how good God has been. It's a different year of homecoming. Normally we would pack them in and didn't make no difference where people sat or how people sat. Normally we would have the fellowship hall open and ready to serve. But it's a different year. Different times. But I came to serve you knows that we serve the same God. And if he kept us 141 homecomings, I do believe he'll keep us 141 more. All we got to do is trust and believe in him. Normally at homecoming, we would reflect on those who we've lost from the last homecoming to this homecoming. And the good news is that since the last homecoming, the Lord only took, well, we didn't have homecoming last year, so since the last homecoming, he took two. But the good news about the two he took is if it were two that were ever ready, that knew the Lord, they knew him, and they're now resting. And so we pause today and honor Deacon Timothy Franklin and Mother Dorothy Smith to reflect on their legacy and their contribution to this great church. But I promise you, keep on living. A few more sunrise and a few more sunset. You're going to walk up in here and the seat that you once warmed every week, the seat that you once sat in will lie empty as well. Because Jane Cleveland said it this way, he's taken us away. One by one, he's taken us away. And the good news is that when he takes us from here, he puts us over there. And that although we may miss him here, one day we'll join him again on the other shore. We're going to get ready to go before God in prayer. Ask God to bless our worship experience. We want to pray for all those on our sick and bereavement list. I ask you to pray for two wonderful friends of ours, Sister Quinn Kearse and Sister Tamise Scott. Both of them funeralized their husbands on this weekend. Tamise is actually funeralizing her husband right now, and Quinn funeralized him on yesterday. Two young men, just 36 years old, have gone home to be with the Lord in the midst of this pandemic. As I talked to one and have reached out to the other, the only thing they keep saying is, the same faith that brought me here, I just got to believe it's going to carry me through this. So I ask you, pray for the Kearse and Anderson and the Scott families as they go through this time of bereavement, and all other families, because it looked like we were almost through this thing. Looked like, I'm not going to lie, I was about to celebrate too. Looked like we could see light at the end of the tunnel just a few months ago. And it came back with great vengeance, looks like, as we endure this next wave. But the same God that kept us through every wave is the same God. If he can speak to the waves on the sea, he can speak to the waves of a pandemic. And he can say, peace, be still. I would not have you ignorant, brethren, concerning those who are around you. Just because they come to church today and dressed up, they need prayer too. And so we're going to pray for one another. Because what you stand in need of might not be the same thing your neighbor stand in need of. But we all are standing in the need of prayer. Let us go before God, our Father, and our God. We do say thank you. Thank you for our late night lying down. Thank you, sir, for our more early morning rising. Thank you for clothing us in our right mind. Thank you for the use and activity of our limbs. Thank you for tongue to talk, ears to hear, eyes to see, hands to clap, and legs to walk. We realize, God, it could have been the other way. We could be somewhere hoping to be in the house of worship. But since you gave us the strength, since you gave us a church-going mind, since you gave us vehicles and gas to make it here, we will not take this opportunity lightly. But we'll say thank you. Thank you, oh God, for this day that we've never seen before. And this day that we shall surely never see again. And we say thank you, God, because you're the only one who's able to make a day. So we thank you for this day. Now, God, as we gather inside your sanctuary and on the grounds of this great church. We ask that you would touch us at our point of need. Touch us from the crown of our head to the soles of our feet. Some of us come in needing you for one thing and some for another, but we know you're well able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we could ever ask or think of you to do. So now, God, touch us as only you can. Greet us as only you can. Hold us as only you can. Heal, set free, and deliver as only you can. God, we don't want to be selfish and just pray for ourselves, but we come in with family and friends. Look down our road, Lord. Touch them at their point of need. Meet them where they need to be met, God. Dry their weeping eyes and calm their every fear. Bless my neighbor, God. Bless my family member. Bless my friend, God, in the name of Jesus. Hold them in the hollow of your hand. God, we pray right now for your choice blessings on my neighbor's house. Bless my neighbor. Touch my neighbor. Heal my neighbor. And God, when you've done your best work on them, come on down a little further and do your work on me. And work on me till I walk right. Work on me till I talk right. Work on me till I sing right. And work on me until I look just like you. Lord, have your way, for you are the potter and we are but clay. Lord, we will not leave this place the same way we came, in Jesus' name. And the saints of God said amen, amen, and amen. We give God the glory. We give God the praise. Go ahead and put your hands together and thank God for allowing us to assemble in his house this morning. Amen. Our praise team gonna come forward and lead us further in worship.
Welcome to our Family and Friends Day, homecoming. We know that as we celebrate this holiday, we're celebrating our friends and our family that are here and that have gone on to be with God, as he said. But we know that there is no greater friend that we can ever have than Jesus. And for some of us, he's not just a friend. He does feel those voids in our life, our loved ones that's gone on as well. And this song just says, there will never be another friend as dear to me as you. So if that is what you can say, then you can close your eyes and worship with us, and you can sing it with us if you know it.
Always worth the wait. It's faithful.
and love and know that they love you back. And this song says, be blessed, my brother. Be blessed, my sister, wherever this life leads you.
I'll pray for you. Watch.
And watch.
How many of y'all believe that? And
I'll pray for you.
You
pray for me. And watch my chances.
And I'll pray
for you. You pray for me.
And said, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptation? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Just take it to the Lord in prayer. That's all they tell you. You pray for me, I pray for you, and let's watch God change things. My God, Romans chapter 8. Chapter 8, and for the sake of this sermonic spotlight, we're going to look at just one verse, verse 18, Romans chapter 8 and verse 18, Romans chapter 8 and verse 18, Romans chapter 8 and verse 18. I'm reading from the New King James Version of the Bible, so it may differ slightly from yours. It reads thusly, for I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. I'm preaching this simple thought as you take your seat. What are you hoping for? What are you hoping for? Might we pray, Father, my God, we're thankful and grateful for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. We thank you, O God, for allowing our golden moments to roll on just a little while longer. We thank you that you allowed us to gather in your house. Now, God, we've come to the moment where we want to hear from you. None of us, but all of you. Hide me behind the bloodstained cross of Calvary, that men, women, boys, and girls might not see me, but see you high and lifted up. Have your way in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Apostle Paul, as he writes to the church at Rome, tells him to consider. And he tells them to consider a few things. The first thing he tells them to consider is the suffering of this present time. Then he says, I want you to compare that to the glory which shall be revealed. And then he says, in us. You missed it. Let me wind the tape. Let's go back to childhood. The Apostle Paul seems to paint the picture of a parent with a loving child who says, I know that school may be difficult right now, but don't worry. In a few more days, you're going to get to a break, and you're going to be able to enjoy the break. The Apostle Paul seems to be talking to some downtrodden parent who been going through and say, it don't seem like I can get any break. It looks like I'm just working and feeding and washing and working and feeding and washing. And he says, this present suffering is nothing compared to when you get them grown and gone. This present washing and cleaning and bathing and fussing ain't nothing compared to a few more days when you're able to open that door and say, God bless you. May heaven smile upon you, but I've done the best I could. Now you go do what you can do. The Apostle Paul seems to suggest that the way that we handle our current condition is to have some hope of a better and brighter future. You missed it because you're sitting here saying, Pastor, you don't understand how things are right now in my life. I don't have to understand how things are right now in your life. I know how things are right now in the world. And oftentimes, if you get caught up in what you can see, in what you can feel, and what you are experiencing, you forget that we don't just live in the present, but we live with a hope that no matter how rough, how bad, and how tough our current condition may be, we have a hope that things will get better after a while. Somebody missed it because you say, Pastor, there is not a lot of hope in the situation I'm going through. You don't understand what I've been through. You don't understand the nights and the tears and the pain and the suffering. And I came to tell you that you ain't the first one to go through. You won't be the last one to go through. And the hope that Big Mama them had is the same hope that we have, that if God brought you to it, he's big enough to bring you through it. I don't know what you may be facing today. I don't know what trial, circumstance, situation, but the good news is that if God brought past generations from glory to glory, he will do the same thing for you and I. As a matter of fact, he told us in his word in Romans chapter 8, around about the 28th verse, that all things work together for the good of them who love God and who are called according to his purpose. Wait a minute, Paul, you can't tell me that all things work together for my good. He says, yes, I can, because that's the word. That's the Bible. And I know they might not all be good, but I can promise you that they're going to work out for your good. I know you can't see it right now. I know you don't feel it right now. I know you can't rejoice in it right now, but don't you give up your hope. Don't you give up your joy. Don't you give up your faith, because trouble don't last always. So, Paul, what are you trying to tell us in the text? What are you trying to tell us in the text? He says, I'm just trying to tell you three quick things, and I'll take my seat. The first thing is, he said, you got to be real with yourself. Say, be real with myself. He says, for I consider. Watch what he says. For I consider that the suffering of this present time. Paul, wait a minute now. We know your history. You were Saul. You were one of the chief sinners. But now you are one of the greatest apostles. You're going around performing missionary journeys. You're healing the sick. You're delivering people from demonic attack. You yourself have been delivered out of the hands of angry mobs. And you suffer. You going through. Paul said, let me tell you something. It don't matter what title you have in the church. It doesn't matter what letters you have behind your name. It doesn't matter how many zeros you have in your bank account. Trouble, trials, pain, and suffering are going to befall us all. And can I help somebody today? Can I help somebody today? Because you've been listening to that other gospel and not the gospel that told you if you just had enough faith, you'll never have to suffer. You'll never have to worry. You'll be wealthy and healthy. I came to tell you, you can have all the faith in the world. You can have faith the size of a peach seed, not just a mustard seed, and you still gonna have to go through. I wish I could tell you there was some way to avoid life's troubles and life's pain, but I came to tell you, my beloved brothers and sisters, you just got to go through. I wish I could tell you to get this holy oil, pour it on yourself, and turn around three times, and by the time you get home, everything gonna be all right. But I came to tell you that might not work. As a matter of fact, it probably ain't gonna work, because all of us have got to work out our own soul salvation with fear and trembling. Catch this now. When Jesus came, some of his disciples felt the same way you felt, and they felt that they should be able to avoid life's troubles, life's pain, and life's suffering. And you know what Jesus told them? That birds have nests, foxes have holes, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. In other words, if I am the Christ and I got to go through, guess what? You just a disciple and you gonna go through too. I didn't come to tell you any comfort today. I didn't come to give you any false hope today. I didn't come to try to tell you that you just gonna be able to bat your eye and things gonna get better. No, I don't know if it's gonna get better tomorrow. I don't know if it's gonna get better next year. I don't know if it's gonna be 10 years from now. I don't know when this pandemic gonna officially be over, but all I came to tell you is this, that the same God that brought us in 2019 before the pandemic got here is the same God that's here in the midst of the pandemic. The same God that kept you when things were going well. It's the same God that keep you when you go in the doctor's office and he shake his head and say, I don't really know what to say. I don't know how you're doing, but all I came to tell you is we've done the best we can. And you got to tell the doctor, I'm so glad you did what you can do, because now God can do what he needs to do. Most of y'all know for the past couple months I've been going through some things in my own health. And every time I go to the doctor here lately, they love to tell me how I should be feeling. Isn't that amazing? So the last 4 weeks, I've had to have iron transfusion because my hemoglobin been so low. Every week I leave, they tell me, your hemoglobin so low, you shouldn't be able to work. You shouldn't be able to walk. This past week, I came in, and they had run blood work the week before, and then the nurse come out there, he looking up and down and all that, and he said, you not dizzy? I said, no, sir, I'm not, but I would like to sit down. He said, well, we're going to have a blood transfusion today. I said, what? He said, we got to do blood today because you below 7. I said, you need to go get the doctor. He said, I make this order. I said, go get the doctor. Doctor come out there, he said, oh, this Mr. Brown. He says, I got to tell you, Mr. Brown is a special case. He said, well, doc, I've been doing this almost 17 years now, and anybody who blood hemoglobin below 7, we give a blood transfusion. The doctor said, but they ain't Mr. Brown. So give him his iron and let him go. He said, well, what if something happened to him? He said, you don't have to worry about him. He knows somebody. They're taking good care of him. And the nurse said, oh, his wife, because she a nurse. The doctor just laughed and said, you got a lot to learn. Because many times we look at what the charts say. We look at what the bank accounts say. We look at what the credit reports say. And we get caught up saying that God can't do nothing with this because this is what the evidence say. But I came to tell you, I don't care what the evidence say. It's what does God say. Because at the end of the day, God has the final say. Now, I ain't telling you to be crazy. Now, I ain't telling you to be no fool now. Because when that hemoglobin went down to 3, I was a little lopsided up here in this pulpit. And I did have to get blood. But now, you ain't getting no more blood now. Because I already got all the blood. And if I need to get any more, I get on first Sunday. You'll catch that in your driveway. But he says, I have to consider my present suffering. Sometimes we have to recognize that we got to go through. And we just got to go through. And I know you get upset and mad because when you call folk, they don't answer. Mm-hmm. You get real mad with them. Because you want somebody to be able to tell your trouble too. I wish somebody pick up the phone just so I can tell them how bad my day going. Tell them how bad my week going. I want somebody to be able to tell them how bad I called the bank and they say ain't got no money. And you say, well, did you have it before you called? No, but I was hoping. Some had showed up. But have you ever noticed people love to call with their bad news? I mean, they love people on their phone call. Oh, man, I stumped my toe. You stump your toe, yeah, it's turning blue. Well, what you calling me for? Let's try to get to the doctor. I think I'm going to just doctor on a little bit. Well, go on the doctor. Don't waste your time on the phone with me because I can't help you. But we find ourselves as humans inclined to bad news. We like bad news. We like to hear bad news. As a matter of fact, folks love to say, why the news don't play more good news? Well, people don't tune in for good news. Right now, everybody looking, trying to see what the hurricane gonna do up there in the Northeast right now. But they weren't worried about last week when it was just raining a little bit because we like to hear destruction, people's calamity, how bad things are. And if we're not careful, watch this. Paul says, I consider the present suffering. The word consider means I just think about it. I don't dwell on it. I just think about it. I have to recognize that I'm going through, but I don't get caught up in what I'm going through. You got the glance, but you can't stare. What you're trying to say, Pastor, I came to tell somebody that if you look at your trouble too long, your trouble will cause your faith to be shaken. Your trouble will cause you to become depressed and stressed. Your trouble will cause you not to be able to look to the hills from what cometh your help. So Paul said, just consider it, but don't dwell on it. Because the truth of the matter is all of us got enough trouble that should have ran us all crazy a long time ago. We've been through enough stuff that should have caused us enough heartache to not be able to sleep at night. Well, he said, don't stare. Just think about it. And don't he say, do you realize your own trouble? He says, but then I want you to take it and I want you to compare it to what God has. He said, realize your present circumstance, but then compare it to what God said. Oh, y'all can't shout. I know why y'all can't shout. I'm rewriting the text. I'm just going to stay in the text. For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. The word glory here speaks of light. I don't know when it shall do it. Okay, watch what Paul says. He says, our present suffering is not worthy to be compared with our future glory. The word glory means light. I'm going to get out of here. Because there are two different meanings of light. We know that, don't we? The first one is the light you can see. So the Apostle Paul literally says that your current darkness, you know how it gets dark right before day. You know how when it gets late in the evening, sometimes it just gets a little more depressing. Long as the sun up, you can keep on moving. But when the sun go down and you got to go in the house and then you realize that loved ones that used to be there ain't there no more. When you recognize the stuff you used to have ain't there no more. When you recognize the friends you used to call, you can't call no more. As the darkness comes, sometimes the darkness can invade our own thoughts. And then we start to say, can't nobody hear me praying. Sometimes we get so depressed in our darkness that we start singing songs talking about nobody knows. The trouble I see, nobody knows it but me. You know, them the songs you sing when it get dog. Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes I feel because it gets dark. He says, but don't let the darkness overtake you, because you've got to remember that every day, in order for it to be a day, it got to have night and it got to have some sun. Got to have some darkness, but it got to have some light. He says, don't get it twisted, because I know sometimes it can get pretty dark. Sometimes it can be pretty depressing. Sometimes it can be pretty distressing. He said, but don't you forget that over yonder's Eastern Hill, every day the sun rises. So no matter how dark the night, the sun will shine again. The psalmist said it this way, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. He says, I don't want you to get it twisted. You're going to have some night. You're going to have some darkness. But don't you let the devil fool you to think that it's going to be night always. Because after the night comes the light. And the good news is that his glory is the light. And I know you thought that the sun was simply shining because it's the sun. But the sun couldn't shine if God hadn't put the sign in the sun. And so every time you see the sun shine another day, that should remind you of how powerful, how wonderful, and the promises of God. For the sun was set in its celestial place. Some say thousands of years ago. Some say millions of years ago. I'm not here to debate when the sun was put in place. All I'm here to tell you is the sun is in its place. And God was so wonderful that he put every planet just a ways away so it could revolve around the sun. And then he put Earth far enough away that the sun would heat us up enough so that we can survive, but it wouldn't heat us up too much to kill us. And he tilted us a little bit. And every time I hear scientists tell you that matter just came, that we just evolved from the primordial ooze, I start to say, now come on now, do you really believe that due happenstance and chance, the earth just tilted. The moon was put in its place. The sun was put in its place. The mountains were formed. The earth were formed. Somebody said, well, I just believe in science. And science says, can I tell you something? That's something science can't understand. To this day, science can't tell you how life began. Science can tell you how life ends, but they still haven't figured out how it starts. And you know what? Why they can't figure out how it starts? Because his starting life was beyond our comprehension. Because he stepped out on nothing, spoke something, and created everything. So no matter what you're going through, you ought to find hope. You ought to find joy. You ought to find peace in knowing that if God could step out into nothing, speak something, and create everything, then whatever I may be going through, he ain't got to come down and touch it. He ain't got to come down and touch me. All he has to do is speak, and things got to line up. I know the doctor might have said cancer, but if he speaks, the cancer got to go. I know they may have said you were denied last week, but all he has to do is speak, and the bank will call you to come in and get your stuff. I know they walked out of your life and you thought it was over, but all he has to do is speak and they'll come back and apologize and say, now I realize I was wrong and I was done, did you wrong? And you can tell them, I forgive you, but I moved on. God bless you and may heaven smile upon you, but we ain't got to be in the same relationship. But I'm glad that God let you know what you did was wrong. strong. He says there's darkness and there's a light. But watch this. There's a second definition for light, and I'm out of here. He says the present suffering. The present suffering in the Bible, suffering is compared to a heavy weight that weighs you down, that burdens you down. Everywhere you go, you got to take the pain and the suffering and the grief and the bereavement and the trouble with you. He says, but the glory is a light. So light just don't mean what you can see, but light means he'll come along and he'll take the burden off of your back and allow you to stand up. And folks are saying, now how are you standing up? How are you walking? How are you shouting? How you dancing and how you praising? Ain't all that stuff you're going through weighing you down? You can tell them it once weighed me down, but I got to know Jesus. And he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you joy. I'll give you peace. You can tell them, I once was burdened, but now I know his glory is a light, and it took the suffering off of me. And they say, how you praising him, but you're still going through? How you're praising him and you still got a bad doctor report? How you're praising him and your bank account still negative? You tell him, because I know if he could take the pain, if he could take the frustration, and if he could take the bitterness away, then what I'm going through ain't nothing for him to solve. Is there anybody here that don't mind slapping yourself a high five and saying, I might be suffering, but this suffering is nothing compared to what God has in store for me? Is there anybody here that don't mind thanking God for the rainy days, thanking God for the storms, and thanking God for the pain? I know you say, Pastor, it don't make no sense to talk about thanking God for rain. Don't nobody want to see rain. We always say, rain, rain, go away, come again another day. But I came to tell you, if you ain't got no rain, you can't get no harvest. If you ain't got no trouble, you can't get no blessings. Because the only way we know how good God has been is we know how much stuff we've been through. And one thing about it, the songwriter said it this way: I've been through too much not to worship him. I've been through too much not to praise him. When I take an inventory and I think about all he's done for me, all the ways he's made, all the promises he's kept, I got to praise him. I got to tell him thank you, because it could have been the other way, but he kept my mind, he kept my body, he kept me until I could keep myself. Is there anybody here that don't mind testifying for just a minute? You ain't got to touch a neighbor, but just wave at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I know you see my glory, but you didn't see my suffering. I know you see my glory, but you didn't see my trials. You didn't see my tribulation. You didn't see the pain. But I came to tell you that if he can bring me through, he can bring you through too. Just point your hand at him and let him know that he's no respect of person. What he did for one, he'll do for another. I've got to get out of here. But I just want one person to find somebody and point at them and tell them, this ain't the end. God's got more in store. Tell your neighbor, this ain't it. God's still working on your behalf. Good God Almighty, somebody can't praise God because you stuck. Worry about what you're going through today. But I came to tell tell you that this present suffering is nothing compared to the glory which shall be revealed in God. All right. Yeah. 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 I don't know about you, but sometimes the way get dark, sometimes the night get long, sometimes my eyes fill with tears, but the good news is I know who holds tomorrow. And since I know who holds tomorrow, now I don't have to worry about what tomorrow holds. Do me a favor, wrap your arms around yourself and just remind yourself that God will take care of me. Tell yourself God will take care of me. You missed it. Just wrap them, hug yourself real tight and say, self, God will take care of you. Yeah. I know the way get dark. I know the burden get heavy. But God will. God will. He will. He'll take care. I gotta let this thing. But don't you go home and be defeated. God didn't bring you this far to leave you now. God will. He'll take care of you. The devil just told you, because of what you did or what you said, that God won't take care of you. You need to tell the devil he's a liar. And he's a defeated foe. Because God will take care of you. In spite of you, in spite of me, he'll take care of us. Holy Spirit just said, somebody here, you think that what I'm saying only applies to certain other folk who been in church and who come to church every week and do all that. God said, ain't got nothing to do with how often you go to church. If I take care of them, I'll take care of you. Somebody said, well, I don't really have faith. Like everybody else got faith. It's okay. The centurion soldier came to God on behalf of his son. And you know what Jesus told him? Your faith will make your son whole. He says, I believe, but help my unbelief. And Jesus said, go on home. By the time he got home, guess what? His son was healed. In spite of his shaky faith. And I know oftentimes you see us in church and you see people in church and you think that Jacob, people in church, our faith is never shaken. If anybody tell you they've never had their faith shaken, they've never experienced God. Because when you go through life, when you go through trials, sometimes you have to wonder, God, where you at now? I thought you were going to do it this way, but you did another way. Tell you, these last few weeks, me and God had a lot of conversation when it comes to faith. As I've been praying for healing, and he decided to do what he was going to do. Matter of fact, I was kind of angry with God last week, all week, really. And in being angry with him, I think I took out a lot of my anger and frustration on other folk. Because it just didn't seem fair. But lo and behold, even in my anger, God said, okay, I'm going to help you out. And me and Reverend Kearse, we're good friends. But his father-in-law is a pastor. His brother-in-law is a pastor. I had already resolved, told my wife, you know, whatever they want me to do in the program, I'm doing the program. His wife said, we're going to call you. She called and she said, I need you to do the eulogy. I said, you probably don't want me to do the eulogy. She said, why? I said, because me and God got to talk. And I don't need to have this conversation be public. And most of y'all know all my friends call me Brown. She said, Brown, I think that's why God told me to tell you to do it. So by the time Saturday got here, I had to deal with that thing because I couldn't stand and allow my bitterness and frustration with God to come out in the eulogy. And I asked God to soothe my heart. And I preached the eulogy. And it still was a little shaky. And you know, you preach eulogies, most people don't listen to eulogies. You go in one ear and out the other, right? It's just part of the service. Especially when you went to feel like that, it had good singing. Wonderful words and all that good stuff. After the service, a young lady came up and said, my husband lost his father last month, and your eulogy today gonna help him through that last month. I said, well, praise God. To God be the glory. I was still a little angry and upset. This woman went home and went to our website and said, I know you probably didn't understand what I told you outside the church, but I wanted to make sure you understood that my husband, and he's a reverend, was having a hard time with the death. But what you said today has helped him. By the time she said that second time, you know what I had to say? Okay, God, I see. Even in the midst of me not want to do it, you still got the glory. Sometimes we don't know why God takes us through what he takes us through, why we have to endure what we have to endure. But he says, at the end of the day, I'm going to get the glory. It was never about you anyway. It was so that men, women, boys, and girls could see me. Because it's only when I am high and lifted up can I draw men unto myself. So the last part of that glory in that light is like a light from the lighthouse. That your suffering, your pain, what you're going through is going to help lead somebody else to Christ. To find him. To find strength. To find hope. And to find salvation in him. And right now you sit back and say, but is there any other way besides me going through? And guess what God said? Yeah. But I decided that not only are you going to suffer so that I can get glory out of you, you're going to suffer so that I can get glory out of other folk. So you have to say, God, get the glory out of my life. However you want to, get the glory. All praise and glory be unto him. Maybe you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ and a free part of your sin. If you died right now, you don't know if you would spend eternity in heaven. I want to invite you into a relationship with Christ, there's truly nothing better than knowing Jesus. He will pick you up and turn your life around. You ought to know him. Get to know him right now, today. Just come.
There's nothing better than knowing Jesus.
He will pick you up.
He will pick you up and turn your life around.
You ought to know him.
You ought to know him.
Get to know him.
Get to know him.
When should you do it? If you're here today and don't know Jesus Christ and if you're part of your sins,
you're knowing Jesus. He will pick you up and turn your life around.
You ought to know him.
You ought to know him.
Get to know him. Standing, we thank God for each and every one of you, our Father's children, for being with us today. We thank God for all our family and friends who come to celebrate homecoming with us. Due to our protocols for making sure we social distance, as you leave, we're going to give our gifts through the back door. I think the ushers might be outside, so we're going to ask Deacon Shy and Deacon Freeman to be at the back doors to collect the offering. Give us God his purpose on your heart. If you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. If you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. Homecoming, y'all normally give to the cemetery, so give. It's been raining a lot, so we got to cut it again. Right after worship service, most of you all know, y'all can have a seat right quick. Most of you all know my wife is a family nurse practitioner, and her practice, they do community outreach, and so today she has a presentation on COVID. So if you want to stay immediately after service, if you stay in the sanctuary, she's going to give a presentation on COVID so that you can have an understanding of what it is. It's a brief conversation, she says. Brief. She's never brief when she's talking to me, but we're going to see. That's a joke, y'all can laugh. But she says it's a brief. They're part of their practice is research, so they have to make certain presentations. And so I think they're just trying to use the church. But the good news is they're going to send us a donation. So tell Dr. Felix Sagati, I'm going to stay. And he can go on and write that check. The Macedonia Missionary Baptist Church of Covington. It already been wrote. Where is it? Give me the check. And tell him we need a new roof too, so he wanna pay for that. So immediately following worship service, some of us haven't seen each other in a while, so they set up a lot of tents outside, several tents. So when you go outside and get your food, you are encouraged to stay on the grounds and be under tents. We do actually still try to social distance because this pandemic is real. It's real. Six tents throughout the campus, okay? So go on out there and get your food. You ain't got. We know a lot of y'all used to getting your food and running. We gonna watch the parking lot. I'm just playing. I'll be in here with the presentation, so I won't even know if you leave. But there's somebody watching. I'm just kidding. For those of you who don't know me, you have to laugh. You have to laugh. And I know y'all sitting there saying, look like Pastor Pan's too big. Because I lost some weight this summer. And I got to buy some new clothes. But as I told them last week, when you've been big all your life, you know, you don't go out and buy too many new clothes small yet. You got to wait. Because if you lose it, you're subject to finding it. Brother Cleveland. Michigan, okay. Would you like to say something? Amen. Any other guests will be recognized? Any other guests? Them two ladies right there, huh? They can't. Okay. Well, we thank God for y'all being with us today. Amen. 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 And the rest of y'all look about like home folks, so where y'all are. Amen. And so that means everybody can't run at the same time. But also, if you go get your food, you can't bring back in for the presentation because they don't like you eating in the sanctuary. Okay? So, might as well watch the presentation. Some people just might as well watch the presentation, let the line go down because there's only so many folk can go through. Just a little hint, okay? All right, shall we all stand? We're going to recite our giver's confession, and we'll be ready to go. I tell you what, stand on this side. All right, our giver's confession says, you know what? We got to put it back up there. We got a new computer, and so it's not uploaded, but we'll get it up there. But I know the giver's confession. Thank you. Praise God. All right. So it says, Father, empower me to bless your kingdom. Your word declares that you will give seed to the sower. I will give you nothing from my pocket that did not come from my heart All I have is yours. I will honor you with the first fruits, and I will not withhold the tithe. The devourer is rebuked of my life. I am faithful, productive, and fruitful. Therefore, let your blessings rest on my house. It's offering time, and what do we say? Praise the Lord. Now may the grace of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with all of us henceforth and forevermore. And the people of God said, amen. Go in peace. Oh, let me bless the food. Let me bless the food. Father, we pray right now that you would bless the food, bless the hand.